think I have, it is on 100%, it says. But I
Right,
will bring the computer closer to me.
yeah.
Yes,
Yes, technology, I know. Sorry for my, okay, good. All
Let's
right.
we'll start the session. So I will start this. Welcome to the 8th Agri India Meet. Agri India Meet is a series of online speaker sessions. We're having open dialogues and conversation with academicians, startups, entrepreneurs, industry experts, policy makers to explore technological advancements and developments in the field of agriculture. These sessions were typically started as a community building activity for Agri India Hackathon, an initiative by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare in association with Pusa Krishi. After successful series of Agri India meets at Agri India Hackathon, we are excited about making it as a regular feature with Pusa Krishi, which is an agri-tech business incubator of ICARI, IARI Institute. The upcoming Agri India meet that we in today's session, we will be talking about future of foods, the new technology, emerging trends, genetically engineered food, and what are the biggest hurdles towards achieving food security. So I would now request Dr. Neeru Bhushan, CEO of Pusa Krishi, to formally start the session and introduce the meets.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Ma'am.
Distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen, along with all the young startups and entrepreneurs, a very good evening to all of you. I, on behalf of ICARI, welcome you all in our 8th Agri India Meet, which would be focusing future of food challenge and opportunity. The series of Agri India Meet was initiated, as Priyanka has mentioned, last year with the launch of Agri India Hackathon, which was inaugurated by our Honorable Agriculture Minister, Shri Narendra Singh Tomarji, on 31st of December 2020. So as earlier mentioned, that it is in a, then we started Agri India Meet to create a buzzword and to create the community for the Agri India Hackathon. And we have completed 7 Agri India Meets, and while covering a broad spectrum of sessions like precision agriculture, farming, equipments farming, and then supply chain, post-harvest, investor, industry connect, and with the policy maker. Even the startup has also been given a chance to talk about their success stories. And that's how we are, while keeping technology at the center. So today we are very happy to have a overwhelming response regarding the registration for the 8th Agri India Meet. The main objective of today's meet is to provide a platform to Indian origin researchers across globe and accelerate towards bringing in the latest trend and technologies, what happening in the agriculture and the allied sector. I'm very glad to welcome Dr. Srivastava, who was former lead agriculture scientist with World Bank from United States, Dr. C. Anand Ramakrishna, Director, Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, Tamil Nadu, Dr. Mamta from University of District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., and Dr. Brijesh K. Tiwari from School of Biosystems and Food Engineering, University College, Dublin. So on this line, I'm really very happy to invite our today's, I'm very happy to invite our Honorable Director, Dr. A.K. Singh, to introduce the today's speaker. Dr. Srivastava and Dr. Mamta. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nehru, and I must compliment you for excellent initiative, which has been, started with the Agri Hackathon. I would also urge you that, today only we had a meeting, and India had 75 in August 2022, and it has been decided that the preceding 75 weeks from August 2022, we must have some activities. This is a great initiative, and IRI has been given the responsibility to, talk about education, agricultural education, new education policy, entrepreneurship development, and vocational training. This is the area that is given to IRI, and it would be really, interesting that if we can build a program for India at 75, at least some key, lectures like we are having now as part of India at 75 also. And it is known to everybody that this program has been, it has got an overwhelming response of more than 6,000 applicants. And then from that, 24 have been selected for funding. They are still in the process of scrutiny, and all these lecture series are going to greatly benefit them. And in that process, I have great pleasure to welcome Professor Jiten Srivastava today. I had an opportunity to meet him about 2 years back with Dr. Alka in Division of Genetics. When I was heading Division of Genetics, he was well versed with the RISE work that we are doing, and he was quite appreciative of it. Thank you, sir, so much for finding time and to be with us. As you all know, Professor Srivastava is a distinguished global expert on agriculture and rural development, natural resource management, agriculture research, climate change, and disaster management. He retired as a lead agriculturist at the World Bank and has since served as a senior consultant, advisor in the World Bank, and managed numerous countries and regional programs. Prior to World Bank, Dr. Srivastava was one of the founding management team members of ICARDA, also served there as the Deputy Director General. And he has been a specialist with Ford Foundation in the Middle East and North Africa. He's also a National Fellow of the Indian National Academy of Sciences, Indian Society of Genetics and Plant Breeding. He currently resides in Maryland, and continues to be involved in the World Bank project. He was also quite supportive in all the World Bank led project at IRI and at ICR, be it NATP, and several other funding program. His ties with India is very deep, and almost every year he visits the country and interacts with the community here, scientific community here, and today we are going to hear him at great length. Once again, I would like to thank him for giving us time. We also have Dr. Mamta with us, and she is a project specialist for speciality and ethnic crops in College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences at University of the District of Columbia in Washington. And she teaches agroecology and conducts research and community outreach in areas related to improving food and nutritional security in changing climate. And climate change is such an important area. Our commitment to meet the Paris Agreement commitment by 2030 by cutting down the greenhouse gas emission by 33% of GDP is a major challenge. And we need to have a lot of global expertise as to how we cope up with this particular task that is before us. At IRI, madam, we have a strong program of Environmental Sciences Division. That's the Center for Climate Resilient Agriculture. And we would like to have much deeper collaboration with you in our research program as well. Dr. Mamta is recipient of ICAR fellowship throughout her studies at the University of Agriculture Sciences in Bangalore, where she received the MS degree for her work on medicinal plant. She was also selected by ASRV to serve as an agricultural scientist. And prior to pursuing a PhD in horticulture at the University of Maryland, she worked to promote women group in agriculture. It's my immense pleasure for me to welcome both the speakers for today's program, and look forward to hear to your presentation. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Dr. Singh. So I think we are ready to begin, right? So I'm going to share the slides for both Dr. Srivastava and myself.
First of all, it is truly a pleasure to be with you. And Dr. Singh, again, good to see you. And I see some other faces. It reminds me of my early days in IRI. I think I started there in 65, and I saw the buzz that was going on. And the why I relate with what you're doing now is at that time, even we had good varieties of Larmaraho Sonora 64, but nobody was producing them So I remember Dr. Swaminathan, we going to Jawahar Jayanti village and starting pushing them to push the seed. And then I remember encouraging others, and I think we gave a few pitkas seed cleaners, even to Mr. Barwale, who is now Monsanto. And so those little encouragement made the private sector come, everybody think India today has made impressive progress. So all that is very good, but I truly congratulate and wish that this thing, that the country as well as the world looked at IRI as an inspirational and ideas to do new things. And this one is new. I wish every success to this program and continued support for this, because the other one, I will simply say that if you look at the, from the beginning of agriculture, from the hunter-gatherer, the societies have changed. And as the societies change, their requirements change, even the environment change. And we, the humans, have always come up with some solutions. Those societies which did not come to the new solutions to meet the changing overall environment, then they have difficulties. And while I'm very proud that our India has made enormous progress in all aspects, we are exporting food, your horticulture, everything is going up, but I think our natural resources have a limit. And the challenge for this generation is what can be done, how we can produce more with less. We do not have that thing that we will cut more forest, more land, more water, and more. I remember 60s and even early, the World Bank always thought of projects in just more irrigation everywhere. I mean, there's a limit to it. But the new technologies are coming, which have the potential to produce more. And I believe for the new generation, what is happening, it is golden opportunity to accept these technologies. I will mention a few of those that I am seeing globally are moving and changing the whole food systems. And therefore, I would simply say, I will not talk about conventional agriculture and those things, because you all know very well. So today we will focus with the, what are the changes happening and what are the opportunities for young people and how your program could encourage few people to take few things moving earlier, as we did with other people like seed companies, small ones in the past. So let me have the first slide.
Dr. Srivastava, I just saw a chat that you're still not very audible. So maybe if you can move a little bit closer to the mic, that'll be great. Yeah, I'll start sharing now.
All right.
Okay, this is the first slide.
Well, I would say that this one, we are simply saying that a better understanding of what is the human need, it might come from the plants, from the animals, and also from the sea, and that is important. But also I would like to say that the demography is changing. There is urban areas are moving, and a better understanding of what this wonderful machine does, how it converts what they have again into a cellular level, and how the information is given from here to actually bioprint, 3D print tissues are here and so forth. Do we understand how this information is provided, for where the source to go and what to do. Next one. Let's think about it. I think that the current global food system is transforming at a pace again as never before. And the reasons for them are the population growth, additionally, longer life, more older people and their food requirements, diminishing availability of land and water, continual demographic shift to urban areas, changing consumer requirements and preferences for food and nutrition, innovations in production, processing and marketing, value chains, that is very important. Challenges of large environmental footprints of conventional agriculture, we are hearing all the time, the water level going down, water pollution, air pollution, less land and all that. And urgency for reducing the vulnerability of agricultural systems to climatic risks. How the way we are seeing already globally, there are even more droughts, more floods, more diseases, locusts, etc. And how do we bring resiliency and ensure the foods are always available? Next. This one, simply, I just wanted to say that it is true that the population, the growth rate is going down. But the actual overall population is really increasing, so a lot more food is required. And also we should pay attention that now on this planet, there are more people older than ever before, and their food requirements also changes. So what impact it has? Next. This one again, even looking at Delhi, look at the earlier, I remember in the 60s, Gurgaon, Noida, and all that, we used to have on-farm demonstrations. They used to produce a lot of vegetables, green things to come to Delhi. But now Gurgaon has become a big city itself, and all the DLF and all that has gone. So how the city will get their food, even in India, the population of the cities, urban and peri-urban agriculture is moving. And it is told that by 2050, even in India, the urban population will be 60% of the total population, and that will require different things. Next. Well, this is just wanted to say to bring to what the world has known, that if you look at the Ayurvedic proverb, it says, when diet is wrong, medicine is of no use. When diet is correct, medicine is of no need. It has immense importance, and we should think how the food habits, food change is coming and how it will be produced. And even if you hear from the Western side, the father of the modern medicine, Hippocrates, he said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food. And therefore, diversity of medicine, how do we produce? Do we eat primarily just a few staple foods? Or how are we going to diversify, meet the real nutrient requirements? I think that is a challenge for people. Next. Then what I would say is, what I'm going to say about urban agriculture and this other agriculture, it is not to replace the conventional agriculture. I think the main thing is we should look at improving sustainable food production through conventional agriculture, continue. But tapping the emerging potential of functional foods and specialty crops is an opportunity for the new generation, and we should support that. Promoting urban and peri-urban agriculture, I think this is going to increase, and in a broad sense, our colleague Dr. Mamta will speak much more on that. And it is really working very well. You all have known the issue of how Cuba really made big progress when they were in trouble with other inputs. Also, let's look at quickly the development of novel food system. I believe we should look at the cellular agriculture, plant-based foods, animal cell-cultured products. And we have to not only think of production, but the entire value chain is important. And I would say that what we should talk about when I was earlier there, we were talking about agriculture means agronomy, pathology, entomology, breeding, and all kinds of things. But disciplines from other areas are very, very important. And we should look at from the, from field to fork, the whole thing, and promote them. And youth can play a vital role in raising the profile of urban food systems that we all know. And question is how make best use of it. Next. Well, this, I just mentioned that I have followed the Cuba thing, and I'm very impressed that when they have been, trade sanctions and they couldn't get anything from outside, then they moved towards urban-based infrastructure and so forth. And they were very successful, an example, they did it. So there's a lot of possibilities. Next. What are the novel technologies which I see are moving? And quite a bit is happening in India, but I think we have to make better work and include it in our entire efforts in agriculture and food systems. The plant-based food, many things are already being produced. Even my wife now brings a lot of things instead of bringing the normal milk. I see the, milk coming from walnut, beans, soya, and all kinds of things, which are being promoted. And animal-based meat, stem cell cultured in bioreactor or cultivator of serum containing. This is also moving. And then the microbes are getting very, very important. We have to have a better understanding how we can make them work to our advantage. And even there are efforts to, producing proteins directly from carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, water, minerals, etc. And I would just simply say, I'll mention a few what is happening, but I'm saying this for our young colleagues, entrepreneurs, that this area will catch up quite effectively and a lot of opportunities for all. And we should move not only the production as we had done, but we also adopt as part of our overall effort in increasing food sustainability and nutrition sustainability. Next. I mean, this one here I said, in many countries, the clean milk, egg, and fish is evolving and are being done at plant and cellular level, and they are in the market. So it is a combination of innovation, awareness, increasing the appeal of past-based products, create markets, and that is important. And several countries are already providing a variety of plant-based brands with unique flavors and ingredients. A young group can even contact with them. And there are a lot of opportunities of cooperation. And investment in this space is rapidly expanding. As you know, the many of these products in which Mr. Bill Gates and biggest and other investors are putting money now on some of these newer products. And I hope that Indian investors will also support these kind of startup and activities in India. Next. I just wanted to say and bring to the idea that ocean farming is also started to catch up. India has oceans all around. And two examples I will simply give. One is what they're calling sea paddy, that is Zostera. In Spain and a few other places, they are growing this thing in the coastal areas, in the sea, and it produces grain, which is dense in nutrition. It grows in the salt water of the sea, does not require any nutrients and things, does not require land, no water. And it cleans the seawater as well. And you all know about the seagrass and so forth. This is catching up, and we should see what we can do. Next. And I will just simply say that kelp is, which has been used in the past, but is expanding its market. And seafood farming and actually vertical farming in the sea is another thing that I have noticed a number of companies have started. And all these details we have given in some of these references you can read, but I had the opportunity to talk to someone who is actually already doing it and getting bigger companies. So I just wanted to bring this one, the future of vertical farming, sea farming is a big opportunity. Next. This one, I just put it, is a better understanding. This is for our microbiologists, to a better understanding. If we look at it, is the plant which takes the carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, and the solar energy, the minerals, sucks it, and really does the bioprinting from the information it has and produces the leaf, the stem, the flowers, the fruits, which we eat, our animals eat, then we eat, and then we again break down. Our stomach works very hard in the night to break it down, again at the cellular and microbial level. And then it also bioprints, our 3D prints that makes tissues and so forth. So if we can understand, and this understanding is happening, that how we can use the microbes and so forth, and we directly produce in the lab, in the bioreactors, that will not require land and much less water, et cetera. And the animals, if we can really find alternative, have the same taste, same feeling without actually killing the animals, think of that industry, what will happen next. Well, I was saying the unsustainable of animal production consumption. At the moment, currently more than 60 billion animals per year are killed. Animal production is responsible for more pollution than the world's fossil fuel powered and everything, contributes to deforestation and soil erosion, competes for land and water, emits gases equal to that of combined emission of air travel, paper mills, coal mining, as a matter of fact, and it is inhuman. So some of the technology which are developing that we can produce the cells directly and without killing the animals, that is something that is moving and we should look at it. Next. And the same thing, what if there was no need to kill an animal or human consumption? Lab-grown meat may produce farm animals as food. This is happening. This will move. I hope new businesses in India will also come, because we cannot afford to have so much competition with animals. So cell-cultured meat, cultured seafood is already coming, and let's think about what we can do and how India can support this area. Next. This one I just wanted to say, bioprinting of 3D, this technology combines all the things that we have. We produce the cell, microbes, and the information technology. Already India sells what we call chapati makers. And a number of machines have come that you just have the ingredients, you can make any kind of cookies and pasta and so forth. And so I believe better understanding of how bioprinting and 3D printing technology can be utilized. After all, just think about it. In our printing machines, we have only 4 or 5 cartridges. And by simply putting a push, it has the information, takes that information, and prints every color and beautiful faces with 5 cartridges that you put in. So let us see what are those few ingredients with which all the cells are made. And can we, so I foresee a future, this area will also increase significantly in the years to come. Next. So I'm simply saying there is, the world is changing. The population is changing, as well as the older people are there. People are requiring more nutritious food, fresh fruit and all that. So it's a simple switch rather than a sacrifice. And I think for plant-based options, cultivated meat and fermentation-derived protein, are going to be very interesting and useful for the coming years. Next. This is about the urban agriculture, what is happening. And I will request my colleague, Dr. Mamta, to say a few things about what are the potential. I know in India is also urban agriculture and agriculture is going on. But Dr. Mamta, to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Srivastava. With that overview, the global overview, I'm going to take you all to what we are doing at the University of the District of Columbia and to what we are doing to promote urban agriculture and peri-urban agriculture here. So urban agriculture, as you all know, is a collective term. It includes peri-urban agriculture also most of the times, and it has many other aspects, includes backyard gardens, which most Indians have and promote, and community gardens are also included. There are other urban farms, smaller farms, school gardens, where children learn from a young age about nutritious fruits and vegetables, and they also get an education. They learn about build confidence, learn about team building. Then there is also edible landscaping. Then there's another aspect to it called building integrated agriculture, which they also call it Z farming, which are edible walls, aquaponics and hydroponics, indoor farming, and rooftop farming. And there's sky farming, which is vertical farming. And of course, the peri-urban agriculture has greenhouses and regular large-scale agriculture, but not as large scale as the rural agriculture, but pretty big compared to the urban agriculture. So I have some pictures here showing hydroponics and aquaponics and vertical garden farming at aerofarms and in Singapore. And I picked the aquaponics example from India, which is actually in the outskirts of Kolhapur, I believe, because they employ, most of their employees are women. And I believe that for a society to progress, everyone has to come forward. nobody should be left behind. So with that, we know that urban agriculture holds huge promise. In a study conducted a few years ago, it was found that it was, the authors say, they predict that Boston, with just city space equivalent to just 50 acres, a city like Boston can make a huge difference. We can reduce about 5,000 tons of greenhouse gases, sequester about more than 100 tons of carbon, provide several, about 200 green jobs, produce about 750 tons of fruits and vegetables, which is enough to serve about 200 people per year, according to USDA-based recommendations. So urban agriculture, as you can see, holds a very high promise all over the world. And currently, although hydroponics and vertical farming usually only grow green vegetables and small fruits, we should not forget that there is immense opportunity for other crops, specialty crops and functional foods to be grown here. And also, urban agriculture is not just aquaponics and vertical farming and hydroponics. There are other areas, vacant lots that we can use to grow several other specialty crops, especially the crops that are unique to India, unique to Indian cuisine, and are gaining popularity in domestic and international health food markets. So with that, I want to talk about a little bit about what we actually do at the University of the District of Columbia. This is the only urban land-grant university in the country, in the US. And at the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, where I am employed, we are focused on expanding knowledge of urban sustainable farming to improve food and water security and in improving the health and wellness of our communities within Washington, DC and surrounding areas. We are also interested in addressing global challenges of urbanization and urban food and nutritional security through research and education on several aspects, just like ICAR and IARI are doing. We also have interdisciplinary departments. Dr. Srivastava already mentioned that it's important to have collaborations with within disciplines. So we have several departments working together to promote food security. And we, other than the traditional degrees, we offer certificate courses, short courses for workforce development. And we also offer a unique doctoral program in urban leadership and entrepreneurship. And we also manage USDA programs to enhance community awareness in food production, marketing, and consumption of specialty crops, which I happen to coordinate. So UDC also has something called food hubs. So we use urban communities as locations for small scale urban food systems. And these have four key components. One is food production, then preparation, distribution, and waste reduction. We use biointensive production methods like aquaponics and hydroponics. And they're co-located with commercial kitchens that serve as business incubators. And this also contributes to job creation and urban sustainability. So food deserts are places where there are areas where there is limited access to nutritional, affordable, and nutritional fresh fruits and vegetables. So the idea is to take the fresh fruits and vegetables, fresh foods, to people where it's not easily available. And we also have, UDC has also started, initiated an innovative container fruit production system, which is called the AgPod, with a power company, our local power company, which is called PEPCO. So I don't want to talk too much about it. I just want to say that these are movable forms. These are ideas for young entrepreneurs. You can take this where there is a need. You can park this where it is needed. And these come equipped with LED lights. Although currently we are only using electricity, there is a possibility to use solar panels and rainwater harvesting. We also have demonstration roof gardens on top of one of our buildings at the university. We grow fruits and vegetables, small fruits and green vegetables, and even tomatoes and hot peppers and sweet potatoes. And we conduct educational tours for children, school children, and also the general public. And many times we also give away plants to people so that we can, to encourage them to grow these plants in their yards and have access to fresh foods, healthy, nutritious food. And with that, I want to bring you all to what's happening in India. And I came across several companies that have already been doing hydroponics, which is very commendable. And although, you know, due to shortage of time, I cannot talk about each one of them, but I've listed several of them here, and I'm sure there are many more. And look, they're growing not just green vegetables, but cucumbers, eggplants, or brinjal, and also broccoli. And that is this picture on the top shows basil. And I found maybe there are opportunities to collaborate with them, or to take that model, to recreate that model, and expand to other areas. This is another example. This is actually aquaponics, and on the right side is an example of aquaponics units in Kerala, which is a very good, I mentioned this here because it's a very good example of public-private partnership. So this was supported by the cooperative bank, local cooperative bank, and they started it as a pilot project to help farmers grow chemical-free food. And initially, though only two farmers had signed up, now there are more than 200 farmers. And the government, the Marine Products Export Development Authority is also involved in promoting this aquaponics project. So with that, we can see that urban agriculture is gaining traction in India, and it's moving forward at a very fast pace, and things are happening. There is a lot of information available on the internet, but I just mentioned a few websites here. If anybody is interested, these are good websites to look into and give a lot of information, not just about what is happening, but you can also get some business ideas reading these articles. So that's the reason that why I put these up here. And with that, I want to hand it over to back to Dr. Srivastava to give closing remarks and wrap up this talk today. Dr. Srivastava, you're muted, Dr. Srivastava.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
No? Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Mamta. So I think that what we are saying, that the rapid transformation is happening in agriculture to meet the new challenges of society as well as natural resources. And this expansion is going to happen. And I would simply say that as vital as conventional agriculture is, it may not fully serve the future needs. Therefore, urban, peri-urban agriculture will complement, not compete with conventional agriculture. We need both. And also, I would urge the group that Now, if we can start giving more emphasis, it is important to view cellular agriculture as a revolutionary industry, examine its potential to transform how we produce and what we eat. Next. There are plenty of challenges, and there is no life without challenges. So the first thing is a commitment to sustainable, secure, and nutrition food supply of food to urban dwellers as well, and catalyzing a shift in the food demands, that is the market. We have to create the market. Only production is not good enough. Third one is nothing will move unless there is a solid techno-economic evaluation of new foods of the food system. Unless there is a market, things will not move and it has to be profitable. Think about dairy without chicken, meat without killing animals, harnessing microbes as cell factories, use of fermentation for cellular agriculture, air proteins, and making use of the vacant urban lands. I think challenge young entrepreneurs, as this hackathon is doing, to identify and benefit from new innovations in the food system. Next. There are plenty of opportunities to not only production, I would say, for young people who are listening, they should also think about not to produce the final food. Can they produce the basic ingredients for food? And they may focus on different things. Some of them can just produce a machinery, small new machinery to produce some of this thing. Fermentation technology and alternative product production, both plant-based and cell-based and seed farming, is really increased. And India, with all its knowledge and human resource, I think should benefit from it. There's also a lot of production materials for scaling up. Somebody else can really do putting up together, but the individual entrepreneurs can do something. They can produce the bioreactors. They can also produce machinery for bio or 3D printing. And I believe there's a lot to be done, beautiful opportunities. Next one. So moving on, I am saying that improved data regime for more effective analysis and advocacy is really important. Develop economic frameworks for decision-making through costs and trade-offs. Costs and trade-offs are also important. Development of policy and regulatory framework and financing mechanisms. Development of institutions and networks for quality management, certification, testing, etc. Safety of the food. Strategic coordination between agriculture, health, environment, and trade. It's not only agriculture, but we should bring people much more together. Build institutional and individual capacities through training, and I hope IRI does that and other institutions. Involve private sector in enterprise-based solutions. That is the key if we do all that. Last one. Well, here I'm saying, with economy of scale, these rapidly evolving technologies are poised to make significant impact on the food industry. And I would say the future of food strongly depends on the choices consumers have and the realization of the environmental and social costs to deliver these choices. I wish that every success to what this particular program is doing, and if we can promote this group, this will be a great thing for the country and the world. And I believe that the future of food will depend on the changing community requirements and how do we meet. We should not only think about more efficient way of meeting our requirements. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Jiten, for the wonderful talk and giving the new insights regarding the future of food. And I think there are very new learnings for us. And I'm sure that startups could get the new ideas, how they can build the new future of food by using the new technology, 3D printing, and we can print our dinner. Okay, so that's, rightly mentioned that there are other things that are also policy support, financial mechanism, market changes of the choices. So it's a lot to be done. And thank you, Dr. Mamta, for wonderful presentation and giving us the brief about the urban agriculture and how we can take new challenges. I think these are the new avenues where these startups can think and they can also build up some of their business venture based on these technologies, because these are the need of the hour, because land, we are not going to have much more, and resources has to be used very judiciously. And land is a very prestigious resource for us. So thank you for the wonderful presentation. I'm really very thankful to both of you for making us aware about these new coming up technologies and how they can be converted into the viable business ventures. So now on this line, we have our next speaker who has directly correlated with his research interest towards 3D food printing and recent trends and futuristic food. He's none other than Dr. C. Anand Ramakrishna, who's a visionary scientist and researcher and director at Institute IIFPT Thanjavur. So he's working as a director there from 2016. Before being appointed as a director, he was principal scientist and coordinator for Academy of Scientific and Innovation Research at CSIR CFTRI. So having a long more than two decades of experience in research and administration, and his areas of research include design of engineered nano and micro scale delivery systems for the controlled and targeted release of food bioactive compounds, 3D food printing, engineered human dynamic gastrointestinal system, and glycemic index studies, spray drying and spray freeze drying of food products, and computational modeling of food and processing operations. So I think Dr. Anand Ramakrishnan, so I think your insights will be really, really very helpful to us and to navigate through the recent advancement in food processing operations. So we welcome you, sir, for your talk on the subject. And now I invite you for your presentation, please.
Thank you, Dr. Neeru Bhushan. Really, it's wonderful to meet everyone. And Dr. Srivaswa and Mamta, really, they put a wonderful basis for where I have to start for the future foods. I'll share my slide. And thank you so much, Burgess, joining today, meeting under this platform. Next 20 minutes, I'm going to talk about future foods, strategies for the sustainable food system. If you look at the total scenario of the food processing itself, like millions of years ago, we started hunting, then agriculture practices come thousands years back. Then 100 years back, we started the industrial practice. Then what happened after that? Then we started taking the food for the energy. Then it's become a nutrition. Last 50 years, we are talking about more on nutrition. Now, presently, we are looking mostly on the consumer-driven products. That's what market stands, and industry also wanted towards to that. So what will be the future? If now started looking at the what the consumer demands, accordingly, we're producing the food products, whatever it is, then future, if it is the goes with the consumer demand or something else, and where our industry will sustain. That is the another issue here. If you move on to the consumer demand product, industry sustainable will be question marks, because already that margin of the profit in the most of the food industry is around 5 to 10%. It is not like a nutraceutical industry or pharma industry. Margin is whenever it's reducing, the industry switch over from their focus. So that may be the future, and how industry looking at. If you look at India's perspective, India is the sixth largest in the grocery market, almost 19% of the total workforce in our country. And we are almost fifth in the size of the production capacity and export. And really, we did a wonderful and recently concluded the our statistics on the export increased 13% increased in the last quarter to now, especially for the food and agri. Not only that, the one segment is not shown negative growth during the pandemic situation is the food processing sector in our country. Apart from that, the another one segment, especially for ready to eat, ready to cook product, the demand rose more than 35%. That is the what we are looking. Definitely, this is going to be a revolution. And Ministry of Food Processing has realized that. And recently also Agriculture Ministry and our Prime Minister also talked about one district, one product, that concept. It is evolved in Ministry of Food Processing Industry. Now everybody is talking in our country. That's what any product has come to your table, your plate. One third of the product is travels more than 1,000 kilometers. For example, wheat is traveled from the North India to South, South India to North, coconut, so many things. Almost throughout the globe, that is the statistics, almost one third travels. Can we reduce it? Because of if you travels more, more carbon footprint, more addition to the transport cost added into your product, and how to reduce that. That's what we thought of, to increase the localized clusters. And that's what one district, one product has been evolved. And we wanted to bring more than 25 lakhs micro enterprises are there in India. We wanted to bring into the formalized manner to put it into the mainstream supply chain management. That is what ideal. Now it is not happening. Like what happened, farmers producers company or farmers standing one side, APMC is another side, and look at our supply chain is totally detached from the mainstream production house. Can we connect all these things? If you wanted to connect, you need to put it all these micro food processing enterprises. Even India is doing a wonderful for most of the commodities. We are world number one and two, most of the basic fruits and vegetable grains. But look at our presence in the world business. Fruits is the only 1.2%. Vegetable, we are world number two, but vegetable, our world third, is only 1.6%. Food grains, we have done well, 18%, but spices, 16%. But still a lot of gap is there. The small country like Spain and other countries are doing very well, more than 40 to 60%. Why not India can't do that? Because we are unable to connect the market. I'll give the one small example on this point of view. If you look at whole Europe, what 2017 they imported the biscuit worth, India's contribution is less than 0.00, less than 1%, 0.001. India has produced almost 100 million tons of the wheat, 270 lakh tons of the sugar. Why we can't convert these two things into the biscuit? Because we are unable to understand what is the consumer wanted in Europe market. That is the what we need to think, how best we can put ourselves into the what is the consumer demand driven market, how to create in our ecosystems. And for me, if you look at these are the sustainable strategy, if you call it, for the future foods. One is the raw material availability. I said that's a key element, including the water availability is not as good as what we have seen in the 20 years back. Right now, we need 2050, 70% more food and 80% more water requirements. Right now, whatever we are available is one third only we are using. So how to feed that much amount, 70% more food, how to produce that in 2050? It is a big, big challenge, especially in India. Yes, this year we produced 280 million tons of the food grains, fine, surplus production. But when population is going to be 150 crore plus in 2035, how we are going to match with the demand of 400 million tons of the food grain? That is the one big challenge in front of us. And the consumer preference, again, because without consumer preference, without market, no industry come forward to do any other product, whatever you do. It will be the lab, it will be the concept note. But if you wanted to convert into the product and you take it, a consumer has to be accepted. And technology upgradation is a most important. Time to time, industry has to upgrade the technology, including the waste utilization. If you look at the whole scenario of food industry itself, wastage is almost 25% plus. Rice, 31%. Wastage, pulse 28%, fruits and vegetable, almost all the fruits and vegetable processing industry waste is 25%. How to convert this waste into wealth? So what are the technologies are available to convert into that? For simple example, if you take it the potato chips making, lot of peel waste is there. Can we take it as that we convert as the starch molecules? Can we use this starch, potato peel starch, can be used for other matrix? So that's what we need to look, where we can get the raw material from the waste. And the nutritional security is the most important, especially in our country. Even though we are doing very well, our hunger index is very, very lower than our neighboring countries, and malnourishment continuously it is increasing. And look at our anemic, almost throughout the country's average of 50%, most of the populations are anemic, and how to sort it out this issue. And then supply chain management, what I mentioned earlier, this is the what we are missing in our country. We need to connect all the dots, either farm gates, or farmers to the APMC or the production house and the large industry to the market. How to put all these things? Can we use artificial intelligence? Can we use the blockchain management? How to manage this whole supply chain management? At the end, we need to look regulations. What is going on right now in India and what is going in other countries and what are the regulations of future? We need to think on the regulation, then you have to start your future foods if you are thinking to do that. Consumer preference, if you look at customization, is the most important. Now people are not taking food for the, even what I said about nutrition. Now people are taking food for soul. When I take the food, I need to enjoy that time. When that food is giving the pleasure to me, I like to take that food. How to customize that food? That is the key element has come to customer preference and nutrition. They want beyond the nutrition. They wanted to go personalized nutrition. I want this is the amount of the protein, this is the amount of the carbohydrate, this is the amount of the all the nutrients. They're going for that. That's what the DNA diets and so many things are coming around that line. So how to manage that one? And now the product range. I said 35% increase in the ready-to-eat products means you wanted to convert all traditional products, for example, idli, pongal, whatever the South Indian meals are, North Indian, converting to ready-to-cook, ready-to-eat type of products. So that is the product continuously increasing in Indian market. Especially local-driven product is moving on very rapid pace than the branded one. So how to balance this local brand and branded one? And convenience and taste and ethical food choice, I'm going to talk later, and brand trust. It is there in everywhere. But in the food is coming very recently, the brand, I am wearing all the branded one. Why not? I'll take the food also as branded one. That's what it is going on to that. How to create such type of brand around your products. So all these things moving around the consumer's mind. One such things, if you look at the Sonic enhanced food, when they deliver the food in front of you, it creates the music with that. Because normally we look into the our eye, then color and presence is good, then smell will come to your nose, then you take the food, putting it to the tongue, then you are enjoy the food. So eye, nose and tongue. Now your ears also come into play. When they deliver the food along with the music, you try to enjoy it. One study in the UK, they deliver the fish along with the seashore sound. The intake is increased 3 times. So because of that, the sound makes people to enjoy, but that synchronize with that. So how to make that in the marketable product? As I said earlier, it's only 5 to 10% in the profit margin. Such type of high-end product, when we move, definitely we can get high amount of the profit margin. For example, low bass sound makes you feel like a more bitter type of sweet, a bitter type of taste. Or the piano type, high pitched tune, that like a bell type of things, it makes sweeter. So this is the, again, it's a depends on individual perspectives and how the individuals approaches these sounds and food. So we need to synchronize this psychological behavior with the sensory perception, all these things. In IFPT, already we started working on all these things, how this all this correlation between the all these 4 components. So definitely this will help to move on to the making the high-end product. And Srivastava has touched about the market demand, plant-based meat analogs is continuously growing because the cost of this meat are increasing. So people are looking on side alternative. Another one is vegan foods is moving on to this direction. Can we do plant-based meat analogs? One is that, for example, this is the continuously increasing, like almost 6.6% increase in the growth rate of plant-based meat. It's the wonderful meat analogs we can create from the whatever I listed, the cereal product, legume and other product. IFPT also is working on, we created some of the meat analogs from the matrices like a texturized protein and we structure it, such type of proteins. Only thing we need to play around, which is the technology you are using. Can we go for the shear cell technology or spinning technology or vector electro? We are using both the technology to create such type of meat like a structure with the protein. It is a possible to do, but again, consumer, how they are going to accept. And a lot of people already in the business and we are also working on it, but it is another area one can think about how best we can, but this is going to be a really future. And because if you make it a cost effective, this is going to be a change, the big game changer. That's what most of the industries are moving on to that. And again, is the other way look into that. And if you take the stem cells from the animal, you grow the meat in the lab itself, in the petri plate itself. For example, first cultured hamburger has been done in the August 2013 itself on company. It is possible to do that such type of in vitro meat. And this is like a cell cultured meat. Definitely, this is the another one area definitely is going to be dominant in the future. And recently, you would have looked into that. Pepsi signed a contract with the Beyond Meat. Beyond Meat is started very late, like a 2012, but now it's one of the leading companies creating the alternative meats. So all the leading players in the food industry is moving to these directions. So definitely it has the lot of scope how to do that, but it needs lot of inputs from other side. For example, you wanted to create some of the proteins, how to make it that protein for such a like bioavailable as well as pedic as value, everything the high end level compared to the animal protein. If you're able to do that, yes, it has the lot of potential into the market. The same thing, algae based meat alternative startups, again, is continuously increasing algae because it has the very high rich in the nutrition. For example, it is the good amount of proteins and other matrix for omega-3 fatty acids and other things are there. Even some people are now, they try to use algae or the any cultures, bacterial cultures can use for the creating the air-based protein. Can be created the protein structure from the air and take the nitrogen and other things to get that same amino acid structure. But possible to do that. But this is a very cheap source. We'll get it and very easy to convert into the such type of nutritious product. That's what people are moving into that, but a lot of work needs to be done. And particular, which is the one seaweed you wanted to take it, which is the algae you want to take it, and how we are going to convert it. And milk alternatives, again, another demand future is going to be like this. Because all we know that whey is a cheese whey. Once you make the cheese, you throw the whey. That's what it was there 25 years back, and people have started working on the cheese whey. It has the wonderful protein called alpha-lactalbumin and beta-lactoglobulin. So very, really is good, especially for the beta-lactoglobulin. It's a globular protein and film-forming characteristics. Everything is fine. That's what this market continues to use the whey protein in most of the matrices, food matrices. What happened afterwards? Cost is gone very high. Now industry is thinking, can we have any alternative to whey protein? So where is that? Can we use the soya or coconut? Coconut has the good amount of protein, almost 28%. Protein is there, rice, hemp, soya, all the things. Can we create the protein from such sources? If you wanted to create the milk-like structure, a milk-like liquid from the hemp or coconut, yes, it's possible to create, but problem is how long it stay. Phase separation, it will occur very quickly. If you wanted to avoid phase separation, you need to make a droplets, is the micro or nano, and you need a surfactant. You can use the natural surfactant. How to make ionic strength such a manner, phase separation or flocculation or creamy should not occur doing that. So that is a big challenge in it, but it's possible to convert. Is the either coconut or chia, we can convert as the milk, and milk alternatives definitely is just the future. And this one area, people may not like it, some people, but yes, we need to think closely. 10 kg of feed, if you give, animal will produce the 1 kg of meat. At the same time, insects will produce 9 kg of the meat. The same 1 kg of meat has the 52% of the protein. The animal, in case of insects, it has the 72% of the protein. Grasshopper already in India, some part people are using. Some other countries is a staple food. People are using it. Why not we'll take this type of proteins and convert and adding it. Because protein cost is increasing, the supplement and the nutrition supplement, if you're looking alternative proteins, this is the another source. And this market also, you can look at market continuously, it is increasing in this area as well. And superfoods, yes, if you, this is a very recently taken the statistics in US, 56 people wanted to buy only superfoods products. The list I have given is a very big list. People wanted, they wanted a health conscious, they wanted to go for superfoods. You look at a green tea, coconut water, coconut and turmeric, all these things, even after the COVID background, this turmeric, garlic, all these things, people are thinking is immune boosting, but we don't have this. Still, we are looking how is the markers to convert or find out this is the immune boosting compounds. For example, hemp seed has the very good ratio of omega 3, omega 6. People are telling when I will take the hemp based product, we feel the pleasure. But we don't have the proper scientific evidence for that. But people are going towards that. Even millet has been added into the superfoods, but we need to drive this around how to convert this product. For example, it has one problem for most of these products. For example, millet, if you convert it to millet flour, storage is the big problem. 3 months after that, you can't store. So these issues are associated with most of the superfoods, but we need to work on to convert this into that. And if you see that ethical food choice, and people, almost out of 10 people, 4 people wanted to buy ethically manufactured foods. Recently also some, you would have seen that list launched a mobile phone. They're not even given some charges. They're telling, no, we are a very responsible industry. We don't want to spoil this earth. That is the, what people are looking, some responsible industry. Why not in food industry as well? The people look into that, that industry beyond that packaging, beyond the nutrition profile, they wanted to see how they manufacture the product. No child labor, low carbon footprint, the fair trade practice. If they does and they declared we are produced ethically manufactured this product, they wanted to prefer that product even higher price. So this is the what market demand continuously moving on, that consumer wanted to do that. Not only the food product, beyond packaging, beyond how the manufacturing practice, consumer is looking into that. So we need to be careful about all these things for the, when you are thinking about the future foods. And technological upgradation is important. Any industry, they need to update and they need to upgrade their things. So that's what we need to think. And scientists like us, we continuously give the solution to our industry. And we need to see that how best industry is adapted. And we also give the solution. One such example is spray drying and freeze drying. This is a well-known part and parcel of our food industry. For example, spray drying, one unit operation produce the single stage production of the milk powder or any capsules. Most of the 80% of the pharmaceutical formulations are come from the spray dried particles. But problem is, it's a heat sensitive product, is very difficult to do it in the spray drying. Alternative is freeze drying, but it takes very high, long drying time. For example, coffee you spray into spray drying and freeze drying, 10 times the price is very high because of the long drying time. Can we have any alternative? Can we do the marriage between the spray drying and freeze drying? That's what spray freeze drying is evolved, and we have developed this situation equipment at Loughborough University, UK. And later we have done work at CFTRA Mysore as well as here. So spray into the cold gas, you make that whatever the liquid into the ice crystals, because millions of the ice crystal forms due to the nucleus in very rapid stage. That's what you need to do, the very exposed into the surface areas too high. If you atomize that exposed in the cold gas, immediately ice crystal forms, then remove by the sublimation, you'll get the very good porous structure. That's what we could able to create soluble coffee powder, whey protein, DHA oil, vanillin, vitamin E, probiotic. These are the product has been produced, but as fine, we have done it in the lab level, but this may be the game changer in the future. If you make it a multi-layer encapsulate using the spray freeze drying, you can deliver the flavor compounds in the layer by layer, then this may be the better choice compared to any other multi-layer encapsulation techniques or whatever is available presently. And whatever Srivas was touched and the madam has told about, we are working in the 3D footprinting at IFPT. And not only we are looking the converting the matrix into the printable form, we are also developing the machine itself. And we wanted to make it a 3D printer more cost effective. And we wanted to take this 3D printer in the almost all the household things. That's what we are working, and different type of printers we are working. But this may be the different way of looking into that. Food industry is the always makes the tons and tons of the products, and one recipe throughout the globe, wherever you go and buy one, whatever the famous chocolates, the recipe is same throughout the world. But here, that recipe changes with respect to the person. That's what is a totally personalized one. And apart from that, you can customize your shape, and you wanted to deliver the nutrient as is possible to do that. Can we do all these three things in the single component as 3D food printer will do that? And we have done this food 3D printer is a first scientific papers from the India. We brought it to that. And this is the 3D printer what we started working with initially. And we developed this 3D printer in the different matrix at IFPT. And this is the multi-head 3D printers also developed. And it gives very clearly, you give the dimensions, and whatever the dimensions you give, that will be printed according to that whatever the feed you given. And the only thing, problem in food 3D printer is the rate at which produce the product. So that can be manipulated or modified with the number of the nozzles, what we have done. If you increase the nozzles, then production rate can be increased. But the shape and size, whatever you want, you can easily print. And some studies, what we have done, if you look at a chicken does not have the fiber. Can we have the chicken with the high amount of the fiber? That's what we printed. We have taken the fibers and even some proteins from the mushroom. We printed the butterfly. That the shape we created, we could get the snacks like that. But only thing, post-processing, you have to do the post-processing. But now we are working in the printer with the post-processing. Both together, already we started working on it. And one myth is that you can't print a very high fiber product into the 3D food printer. Because of it comes the extruder, that you have the shear rate. It may not be suits for the making such things. So what we did, even we have done the wastage, what is created from the pulse milling and other industry waste, we could make the snack with the fiber of 17% fiber, 10% protein snacks. It's a really good substitute for that. That's what the matrix, we are printable matrix, we are converting it. Even egg, we have converted into matrix, and we are using the same food 3D printer to create artificial meat, layer by layer meat, and all the things. We can play around with that. This is the one small industry in your hand. You can use and do that whatever you like to do that. Even what we did, we have taken the rice husk and we converted into the 3D printed casing and all. For example, alternative single-use plastic, most of the states are slowly banning. What is that alternative? We can take the waste, we can convert the shape, and you can make in the 3D printer itself, company logo, whatever you wanted to do it. And even you can create the edible plates and cutleries and everything. And coffee, this is the one area, definitely is the people love to drink coffee, and people like, some people like espresso coffee, some people like cappuccino coffee. That both has the uniqueness, because cappuccino has the milk, you steam it, you create that protein into the matrix, you create the foam into that. Can we create the same type of foam in the espresso coffee? That's what we have done. And we use the coffee oil itself as the natural surfactant to align into that, keep the foam more than 2 hours. It's possible to do that, but only thing, how best you can align this surfactant. Like you have the chlorogenic acid as the head and hydrophilic tails, and align particular manner, nano patterning. If you do that, yes, it's possible to reach a stable foam you can create that stays longer into that. So we can deliver it. And this intact the flavor as well. You look at the top is the air and bottom is the liquid. The foam is intact, and you can deliver the coffee in such a manner that. And another area what I am looking into that is the non-thermal processing, because we used most of the food processing operations are the thermal processing. Non-thermal also will go without heat applications, for example, high pressure processing. This industry, high pressure processing applications is almost late 90s, other countries use. India still, we are very much lagging on that because of the capacity and applications, pulse, light, pulse, electric field, cold plasma, yes, your Bridges is using, and he is also working on that ozone processing and irradiation. These are the areas we need to look. Now, Government of India also is giving a lot of fund to set up the irradiation plant. Such a level, we are able to convince the governments, yes, this is earlier, it was the research level. Now we are moving into the industry level. Yes, possible to do that. So these are the other areas one should think. And IFPT has set up the Center of Excellence in the non-thermal at our institute itself. All the equipments are housed. And Yes, we have seen the market demand, consumer preference, equipment, and product morphology, product creations. But whatever it is, what is going beyond your mouth to the intestine wants to look into that, because your molecule has to be absorbed in your intestine. How much it is absorbed, whatever you are giving, all this not going to absorb. If you look at anemic, I talked about it. What is happening except selenium and vitamin C, only all other micronutrient absorb less than 50%. For iron, it is absorbed only 10%. Can we increase the absorption rate? That means you need to understand what is happening in the oral tribology, bioaccessibility and bioavailability. Bioaccessibility in the digestion stomach and availability in the intestine. These are the equipments available, the artificial human digestive systems. One is the TNO system in the Netherlands, then IFR in UK and other pulsing system or other systems are used. And people have tried to go close to the human digestive systems. Most of the other labs are working on it. And we are also started this type of work in 10 years back at CFTRA, but later we continued at IFPD. We have scanned the human volunteers in the MRI. We have taken the MRI image. We converted this 2D image into 3D image. And I think we have, first time we have printed, like 6 years back, we printed the stomach itself. And we use the same stomach. And this is the what MRI image shows. And you can see the contraction, what is takes place from the here. This is the what stomach contraction. And this is the air gap pushes your meal down. And can we create exactly the same thing in the artificially? That's what we created here. And earlier, we used to study the absorption and digestion behavior. We move on to that. Is it possible to convert this same stomach to study the glucose absorption? Even glucose absorption itself has the very limited in vitro methods, Goni et al. And only two papers are there, very well-known papers accepted worldwide. We wanted to modify that methods, because that all in vitro method, after 60 minutes, that curve never comes down. But actually, human trial, you can look at this graph, what is shown there, and the dotted line is the human glucose release. It has to come down after 1 hour of whatever we have given that feed. But most of the in vitro method, it goes direct. But we have put our own mathematical model into that, inbuilt into that. Even we can use this artificial human stomach system to study the GA, glucose release. That's what now most of the industries in India, they are using this system to study the, it is a low GI product. Not only that, you can find out disintegration kinetics, particles movement, or pyrolytic open. All these things we can study. Now we are working very closely with the MRI images along with that in vivo method, because this is the what we created the human digestive systems are very close to that, and we have the TNO system, and all this system has their unique natures, and it has one advantage and disadvantage. Now already we started thinking to correlate between all these 3 to 4 systems, whatever available throughout the globe, and we wanted to come to some conclusion, which is the one good for, which is the products, and which is the matrix we can go for that. And nanotechnology is another future. Definitely, it is there. And Government of India is the very few countries brought regulations into that nanofood technology. But India is really has taken a bold step to, we brought it to the guideline how to use nanoparticles in agri as well as food. Last July, we released the guidelines. Because why? If you look at the nano bulk material, you reduce that particle into the smaller size particle. Surface area increases. If you look at this graph, when particle size is reduced to less than 500 nanometers, absorption is increased almost 100%. When it goes to the intestine, it absorbs more. And for example, green tea catechins, it's per cup of the green tea. People, everybody love to take a green tea, but issue is it has the good amount of catechins. Per cup, it has only 10 milligram of green tea catechins are there. But it's a very, very poor bioavailability. It's absorbed less than 2%. Giving the per cup only 10 milligram is absorbed 2%. How much it goes to our body? So if you increase to the 100 milligram, what to do that? If you increase the particle, reduce the particle size, increase the surface area. That is what nano will help. And till date, we don't have any proper continuous production of the nano matrix or nano particle solutions. Very few techniques are there, but all are produced at a very lab scale, but not in industry scale. That's what industry is not totally come forward to make a nano as the totally production rate. But we are also trying to the electro spraying techniques. If you increase the voltage and polymeric concentration. Just you are putting the very high electric power in the top and you are charging the particles to move to opposite direction. When you increase the potential, electrical potential, it starts spray. That's what we could able to create the nanoparticles. And with this, we can go from 40 nanometers to the 400 nanometer size. And another area is the robotics, and the robotics is used in the most of things. If you look at automobile and most of the, you look at any cars like Audi, and everybody has their own platforms like MPU Group. So many platforms they're using for robotic platforms. Almost they reached the threshold level in the automobiles. But food, the very recent, it is increasing more on uses of robotics. It's almost 60% increase in the growth compared to the, if you look at 2016 to 18. So definitely it is going continuously, it is going to be raised in the robotics. So we need to integrate how best we can use the robotics in the industry. This may be the future of application in the our food industry. Another one is artificial intelligence is used in most of the every field. Why not in food? If you look at food waste, is almost 1.3 billion food is wasted right now. But if you wanted to reduce, can we use the artificial intelligence to reduce the food waste by 50% 2025? Then we need to have the data. How much amount, where is wasted, and how to get this waste feedback, and where is needed. All these things can be used by artificial intelligence to do that. But definitely this type of work need to be taken by most of the institutions. And packaging. Without packaging, you can't deliver most of the product. And if attractive packaging will help, you can go innovative packaging. For example, edible cookies, coffee cup, like how you are taking the ice creams with the cone. The same thing, you can drink the coffee along with the cookies. So you can enjoy both cookies taste as well as the coffee. That's what you need to think. And we can go for the green packaging, smart packaging, or intelligent packaging. All these things now is moving on. And edible packaging is the another one area. It's moving along with that other packaging solutions. Whatever we'll do that, finally, it is a market acceptability is important. So we need to integrate your product and the consumer acceptability. Now in India itself, so most of the metros, 30% of the product is sold in the supermarkets. So how, where you are placing your product and where is your eyeball is moving, where this eyeball tracking, can we do the solution for that? That's what some of the software has been developed. Where is the eyeball smooth that you can get that hotspot? And like where I will look, my height, and where is my color perception, where, which are the colors. Everybody has the color preference is different. I like blue means I will look at the blue type of color. Somebody likes a green color, light green. So such type of innovative packaging solution, including the how it's be aligned, where to place in the self 3 or self 2, all these things we can study, and the, you get the data. That data you can correlate with the real-time data, then you can give the solution. This is the what packaging, it should be a square and it should be a this color, all these things. So IFPTS already is planning to establish food innovation center along with such type of facilities to cater the micro food processing enterprises as well as medium enterprises. They can't get such type of access to market analysis study. So we need to link, that's what I said, supply chain management, market, production and consumer behavior along with that basic food science and technology. If you put all together, definitely we can succeed it. And the last point is the regulation. Government continuously changing some of the things, steps they're taking. One is such steps is reduce the salt, sugar, fat. Already FSSAI is announced, and some countries already imposed higher taxation on the increasing the salt or sugar. What is the alternative? Because without sugar, you can't take most of the product. Without salt, you can't preserve or taste. But how to give the alternative to that? Even we have done some studies to perception of the salt. We changed using the different techniques of the spray drying and electro spraying. It almost gives the pressure. Just it will goes to the your taste buds. When you make the surface area is more, immediately brain will sensitize as more salt is coming. 30% the perception we increase with the reduction of 30% salt. So that's what we tried. That type of things may help. And still, it is a sodium chloride. We can go for the different combination of calcium and other things. People are already working on it. And another area is we can modify sodium chloride itself to structural modification. But this can be used only surface treatment, surface like a chips and other things. We can't use it in the liquid system. So liquid system means you need a different type of approach is required. And the trans fat, recently FSSAI notified, we need to reduce the trans fat fat for presently it is the 5% to 2% in 2022. So that means when you start your company, you need to think how best we can. This is the future. So you need to reduce the trans fat in your food system. Keep in the eye on the regulation. That is the most important. And as per me, these are the four technologies, four broad classification of technologies going to dominate in the future in India. One is the waste utilization because raw material cost is increasing. That we need to take. And IoT-based technologies, for example, big data analysis, ANN, and blockchain. Blockchain is the really good, but we need to see that what best we can do it from the each stage documentation. That will help to mainly for the callback or the traceability for the blockchain application. Definitely will help. So IoT-based enabled technologies will dominate in the food industry in future. HPP is coming up. Some of the companies already started working on to reduce the cost and increase the capacity. And frozen food technologies, yes. You will get that freeze-dried product of the snacks and other things continuously increasing. And vacuum freeing and freeze-drying, yes, these are two areas of mainly for fruits and vegetables. But still, how much oil uptake and water transport, like a mass transport of both, we need to understand. Then only we can make it a proper vacuum-fried product and salt sugar reduction technology. Definitely, that's the future. So we need to look. Such technologies are there for the future. And for me, these are the other product definitely is going to be dominant. So very, maybe the current market or maybe another 2 years time, one is that organic, clean, fresh, non-GMO, immune booster. Maybe knowing the very well, one of the leading company has put immune boosting bread. Within a 2 days, it is taken out from the shelves in the Indian market. Because still now we are not decided on what is the benchmark, how to prove that is immune boosters of our molecule, especially our spice principles. So such things, if you make it ready, definitely immune boosting products are non-GMO, more organic foods. Already it's driving very fast in India. And specific health ingredient claims like omega-3, probiotics, such added products, plant-based diets, and homeland ingredients, whatever it is, the local products, and exotic superfoods. These are the product definitely is going to dominate Indian market. And it's our dream to make India as the world food factory because whole world has to eat Indian food. That's our dream. And with everybody's help, and definitely it is going to be possible if you make it what we are targeting for to make another 25 lakh micro food processing enterprises into the formalized manner. And this 25 lakh micro food processing enterprises to link with the all the research institutions in the countries. And already we plan to build at least minimum next year itself 30 to 40 incubation centers, all the institutions, and it's going for another 5 years time, close to the 100 incubation centers to increase the startups. If you look at the startups, India is ranked third, but how many startups in the food? It's only listed is the 200 plus. We need to increase the startups. We need to cultivate that innovative ideas to our young minds. That means you need a more incubation centers. And if you link everything, this dream definitely will come. And we have demonstrated throughout the globe. Yes, we are delivering the pharma industry has done wonderful job. It's a time for the Indian food industry to do that. And we'll definitely, with the support of everyone, we can make it India as the world food factory. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, sir. This was really a wonderful talk, and it was eye-opening for all of us what you are doing at IIFPT, and I'm sure that youngsters must have taken a note for the new technologies like the nanotechnology and robotics and ethnic food choices, superfood, and I'm sure that your vision that India would become a food factory for the world will come true with the help of these young entrepreneurs. So thank you very much, sir, for sharing your thoughts and for this wonderful session. So now our next speaker is Dr. Brijesh Tiwari from Dublin, a researcher who is working in the area of novel food processing, extraction and preservation technology with a strong focus on investigation of biochemical and microbial kinetics in food and food technology, as we are running short of time. So I'll not take much time. I'll directly invite Professor Brijesh Tiwari for his talk. And I'll request him to restrict yourself for 15 minutes because we are running out of time. Yes. So yeah, Professor.
That's great. Thanks very much. And that's a lot of my job has been simplified by Dr. Anand Ramakrishnan, who really covered what will be really a future of food, not only for India, but from a global perspective. So I come mainly from Chagas, that's from Irish Agriculture and Food Development Authority, and I'm an adjunct position in University College Dublin. So we deal with almost every stream of agriculture. It's a very quite similar pattern of ICAR, the Indian Council of Agriculture Research. Now, if you look into the challenges, this is my own view, right? If you see what are the critical challenges, it's what previous two speakers already outlined, shortage of food, populations, and climate change. So if what is really important and what is required to have some benchmark, if you look into United Nations Sustainability Developmental Goals, so two are really critical when it comes to agriculture and food, although it can contribute to other of the 17 SDGs, that is good health and well-being and responsible consumption and production. So these are the key challenges what we are going to face in 2050, and almost every person whosoever is working in agriculture or food is aware of these challenges, and or we may get some new challenges, something like a COVID-19. Who knows what lies ahead. Now, what are the key questions what we need to answer and how do we address them? Food security versus sustainability. Do we grow more food and while keep preserving the environment? Or what are the key factors which are influencing agri-food sector? Because I do not see that food processing should be taken separately and agriculture should be taken separately. It has to be taken in, it should be taken together. And how do we address these challenges? So the balance, that means we are on really a tight rope, making a food security and keeping things sustainable. The challenges we have is how do we make food affordable, available to all of relevant quality and safety, whilst maintaining our natural resources and resilience of our agriculture system or all resilience of our environmental systems. So if you look into the food security, so these are the map from WHO, which shows which countries are performing well, which country needs improvement. And what is really causing is population growth. That means directly impacting on affordability. Malnutrition, that means again, protein, energy balance. And again, how do we generate a food which are healthy and which can really sustain with our United Nations Sustainability Developmental Goal number 3, and previous speaker already outlined number of different strategies globally and nationally taking place. Another important thing is food losses and wastages. So if we look into our current demand, right, if we see, this is one of the statistics which was compiled by Martin Cole. He was CEO of CSIRO Australia. And if we do need to increase our food, if you see in terms of calories, we need almost 70% increase in food required by 2050. And this is really a big challenge. So what is the way forward? So if you see skyrocketing demand, that means we will have to cause a lot of damage to our climate, biodiversity, and environmental destruction. So what is the solution moving forward? Sorry. So we have only three possibilities. One is reduce the demand trajectory, which may be by controlling population, and it's not in our hand. It's not, it's beyond the scope of this particular topic. And either to filling the production shortfall or avoiding losses from the current production level. So if we look into our current status, if you take any of the agri-food system all the way from production, processing, distribution, retail and consumption, what we see, we do get economic benefit, we do get social benefit, but we are also causing huge amount of impact on environment. That's again in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, ranging for livestock production. This is a big problem in our own country, Ireland here. Crop production, food unit operation, and food wastage. Apart from that, we have greenhouse gas emissions, which are contributing from agri-food sector. These are the figures which has been published 3 years ago in journal Science, and acidification and eutrophication. So these are the couple of challenges what we have on currently. And if we do increase food production, these numbers might increase. Now, if you look at the scenario worldwide, amount of food losses and amount of food we waste. If we club all these waste and food losses in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, this can work as a third biggest country in the world. So that means there are two ways of tackling this challenge. First, we have to have a benchmark that we already have up till 2030, that's United Nations Sustainability Developmental Goals. And also to look into where the food losses and food waste is occurring. That means United Nations has clearly outlined what are the sustainable developmental goals associated with production losses, that's 12.3.1, and food waste indices. And if you see what we face in developing and underdeveloped countries is mainly on the processing losses at agriculture level, as well as in the primary processing, where retail and consumption are mainly of European countries and developed nations. So if we tackle this, if we are able to control our losses, we will be at least will be addressing number of United Nations developmental goals, then 1, 2, 3, 7, 12, 13, and 15. So this is one of the benchmark what has been what has been set at the moment for Horizon Europe moving forward. So what are the opportunities? So there are two basic opportunities. One is either we reduce the wastage or we transform inevitable waste. So that means for biotransformation towards zero waste, that means we have to develop a resource efficient approach for sustainable production and sustainable utilization whilst reducing the energy and water consumption and decrease chemical use. So EU has activated bioeconomy. So if there are two key points, one is using better what we already use or unlocking the potential of sea and ocean. As Dr. Mamta and Dr. Srivastava already covered about seaweed and different new sources. And we have to learn from our previous experiences, how do we get the best out of bioresources what we have, and how do we untap new resources? So I'll give you only quickly one example of each. One is on food safety and security. How do we reduce wastage? There are a number of different technologies which are already in process of industrial adoption. Majority of the technologies are still having some issues with the regulation because it cannot be used because of food safety and different aspect. But majority of the technology, if we revisit our own processing lines, what the way we process, how we can reduce energy and water, how we can reduce the waste, and how we generate new applications of it. To quote one simple example is plasma. I'm not going to go in detail of it, and the long list of technologies was already indicated by our previous speaker. So this is one of the technology which is a bit advanced than ozone processing and can work in almost all the stream. To quote an example, if you need a nitrogen fertilizer, like pulses, they do not need nitrogen fertilizer, whereas cereals they do need. And when we apply plasma, it forms certain nitrogenous species, which are able to act also as a fertilizer. And it is good for replacing most of the chemical disinfectant, have good effectiveness against grains and different preservation of different nutrients. And how we are working with the plasma technology, if you look into this livestock production or even a food storage or agriculture, this clearly shows if we are able to eliminate the cross-contamination, we can improve the shelf life of a product. If you use plasma in storage systems, that means we can eliminate the cross-contamination. At the same time, in livestock production, it's most of the, I'll quote one example, we worked with the UAE-based company, where chicken houses, well, chicken were produced and they were having more of fat, less of protein. But what was found, when we have plasma air in it, it improves the air quality. When it improves air quality, chicken will be moving. When they're moving, they develop more protein, less of fat. So this shows how the changing the environment will have impact on the type of product or food we produce. And when it comes to fresh produce, obviously this is a system designed as a part of a European project where a packed product passes through a plasma device and it improves the shelf life without the usage of water, because in majority of the cases when it comes to fresh produce, in Europe, chlorine is used as a disinfectant. In some places you use pearl acetic acid, but this employs large amount of water. So this is one of the technology which shows how we can use it from whole agri-food sector, right from harvesting or pre-harvesting, crop production, processing, primary and secondary processing. So moving forward, another example of biotransformational approach, how do we transform the waste? Transformation of waste, either by developing a new processing, new treatments, or new technologies for extraction. I'm going to quote only a few examples. I'm not going to go in details of it. How do we transform? For example, if you take a fish processing side stream, currently in Ireland and most of the European countries, there's no chemicals used in fish. The whole fish, we wash it, we get fillet, and we get protein-rich food. Another way is brining, steaming, canning, and again, protein-rich food. So what happens, the stick water is washing on the fish and fillet when they're washed with the water or with the brine, we lose nearly about 10 to 12% protein and 5 to 8% protein. And simple technological intervention, that means collection of this protein via membranes, either freeze-dried or spray-dried, you get a good high quality protein powder. What is currently happening, all the water, whatever is coming from fish processing stream is going into wastewater treatment, which is having higher BOD and COD. And this particular water, that means we are dumping our protein and lipids coming out of the fish processing into waste stream. And an estimate in Poland, 100 kg of sardines, we lose around 11 kg of protein, 4 kg of fatty acids, and water used is almost 23.5 meter cube. So if we are able to trap the single interventions, we are going to get a good quality protein. We reduce the environmental impact and reduce the water treatment cost. So this has been very successful when it comes to whey protein, which was earlier discarded. And now it's used as a whey protein concentrate. I do understand there is a challenge. That means how do we get rid of fish-like smell? So there are a number of different technologies which can be used. The whole purpose of me giving this example is we, apart from looking for new solutions, new product, it is also important to revisit our existing process line. That means giving the first principle of bioeconomy, that means let's use properly what we are already using. Another example is duckweed. This is what I've seen most of the ponds and the green ponds which turns green. And one of the big projects going on at the moment in Ireland itself, as well as in some of the European countries, is whatever waste we are getting, either it's from meat processing or dairy waste, it contains huge amount of BOD and COD. And it disturbs the ecosystem. Rather than it, this goes to wastewater treatment, collect this water and grow duckweed. When we grow this duckweed, which is having good amount of protein, fiber and starch, and produce this protein, which not only purifies the water, which can dump back to the sea or a river, and this particular protein can be used for animal feed as well as for human food. So human food, obviously, it has to go through regulation. So the turnaround time for protein yield is much faster compared to most of those crops which are normally grown. So these are the two examples which shows how we can exactly transform things to develop new type of sources of food. Now, another approach here is biorefinery approach. For example, if you take any given crop, for example, wheat itself, we have straw, wheat grain, we have seen the problems of burning straw in a field. The only issue was we do know how to use wheat flour, range of different products and processes. If we revisit that particular process and if you take a biorefinery approach, that means the way we get a crude oil and we segregate that into plastics, petrol, diesel, kerosene, different types of oil, same concept has to be applied for any of the new intervention what we look for. Even if it is a seaweed, which has been which was quoted as an example for new source of food, if we go, either we get our protein-rich food or we go for pharmaceutical, nutraceutical, or as an animal feed or plant stimulant. So this is the key focus of one of our two flagship projects. One is Bioeconomy Research Center, and that's Biorbic. Earlier it was a Beacon. And to quote a classical example related to this is AgroCycle, that's for circular economy, it's around 14.5 million euros project, where we are talking about every waste coming out of a dairy processing line for different applications. Because why this has been initiated? Because so far we had a quota over in Ireland that we cannot produce a certain amount of more than a specific level of milk. Now the quota has been removed. So we are looking at dairy milk for different applications. So with this, this is the message for most of the researchers, is we do involve in a lot of basic research, but the biggest challenge at the moment is how do we get to the commercial system? It's very easy to work in a lab. And these are the TRL level, which has been classified in European Union for any project. What goes for, it has to fill in what stream we're looking for. Majority research is already there, and how do we translate that into actual applications? Now, so vital ingredient is local root, global reach. This is a vision of Irish agriculture economy for next 10 years. That means it's going to finish in 2025. And moving forward, we already have Chagas Foresight 2035, where we want to see ourselves in next 10 years. So inverting an old innovation paradigm, normally, generally, what we do is we have research. We look for market and consumer, followed by impact. Now, this has to be shifted. That means research should be consumer-driven, market-driven, and what industry needs, rather than to do the research and tell them we have new product. So this is one of the critical aspect, and our main focus is related to this. And in terms of my conclusion, sorry, I was rushing because already I was given a warning. So we can achieve food security target, though it is challenging, but if we rethink and revisit our existing chain lines, we will be able to achieve that either by transformation or translational approach. That means transforming waste into value-added product or translating existing research towards industry or to the end users. Bridging the gap between industry and academia, technologies are there, but we need to use them depending upon our need. Adoption of circular economy or biorefinery will be the key. And one of the biggest issue at the moment globally is primary producer, mainly farmers, are left out of these innovation chain. Most of the research which has been carried out across globally, like whether it's Nestle or all research, is focusing on multinational to start the processing firm and all. But half of that can be translated to farmer. And this has been a big push at the moment from the European Union to involve primary producers into research so that we can solve and real benefit can go down to the primary producers. Now, thank you for listening, and I hope I was not rushing too fast.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Brijesh. We could not do justice with you, but it was really wonderful talk, and I'm really very thankful to you for putting such a complicated issues in a very simplified way and giving us the new perspective, like the transformation and commercial systems. So, and moreover, on the lines of local for vocal, so local roots and global reach. So everybody is talking on those lines. Now it's a time for questions. I think we are running late. So I'll request, because we are getting a lot of questions. So Shivam, can we select the two questions? So that will be dot on time, because the seminar is still 6 p.m. So we are just having another 5-7 minutes. Yeah.
So should I share the questions now?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So very interesting question is there in front of us. Anyone from the panel, do you think such scale of digitization of food industry would increase hunger rate globally in underdeveloped countries?
Mm-hmm. So Dr. Srivastava, I'll request you to take up this question, because you are working on a policy level. So I think it is related, interrelated question. Yeah, Dr. Srivastava, please.
The question is very right, but my answer is the digitization is first has to define what we mean and what it will do. My own feeling is digitization will be helpful. It will move on. This will become part of the system that we produce, market, and so forth. And it will create more jobs. It will not you know, take away the jobs. That's in short, and unless you want more on that.
Yeah. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Srivastava, for your response. Can we take up the second question, please, Shiva?
Now, again, a very interesting question we have. Yeah. What will be eating in next 20 years?
Wow.
Either plant-based meat substitutes, lab-grown meat, or high insect proteins.
So, Director Sir is here. Dr.
Yes, but we can't. We don't know that. That's what we are moving on to that. And that is the, again, is a psychological and other policy decisions, everything it is there. And even I said about the insect protein, my institute, people are telling why we have to work insect protein in India. So that's what that people mindset has to change. And alternative protein, already I said, this is the what a problem. Industry once adapted, you can't, because still now we don't have how many proteins we are getting from the insect in our plate. Because it's moving on to that, which is the cheaper one, people, industry will move on to that. So accordingly, it will come after 20 years, maybe air-based proteins, because that's what people are telling us, we are getting more amino acid chains equivalent to what we are thinking is the quality proteins. Maybe there after 20 years, but we can't say that. But or we may continue to what we are eating now, or we are going back also. Still, we are going at traditional foods and all other things. So it is depends on the situations. But science is moving on to such directions.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your response. I think Dr. Srivastava would like to add on this. Yeah, sir, please.
That this question is very, very important to understand. It's a basic issue. Mm-hmm. Our, even in India, there's figures that were given today. If you look at it, now there's more diversified food is being eaten. There are more vegetables, more fruits. Even there is a demand for the millets and more nutritious, dense food. And rather than cutting down the staple wheat and rice, that was a major thing. But at the same time, this trend is increasing. Even I can tell you, in my house in Washington, my wife does not, she does bring often the, you know, the Beyond Meat products, which are available everywhere. And sometimes when she cooks the meat exactly and tells the people that it is not a plant-based meat, many of them don't differentiate. So I would suggest that diversification, the need, the nutrition will keep on changing as all presenters have indicated the technology changes, and you can make not only nutritious, but palatable and so forth. So I do see all these have a potential in India and globally, but I like the one of the presenters when he said, make India the biggest food factory for the world. I think that's a possibility and we should look at it. It is not one or the other, but all.
Yeah, thank you. So now it's time for me to...
Professor Brijesh would like to say something.
Yeah, please. Yes.
Sorry, just only one point on a lighter humor. You know, what we'll eat in 2050, it's already been discussed what will be. But I think all the cellular or the new thing, what is coming in now, don't want to see something like what happened to plastic in 1907 when it was invented to replace fibers, natural fibers. Now we are going back to natural fiber to replace plastic. So if whole world turns vegetarian, then it's a problem. And all vegetarians turns meat, then it's a problem. So I think we'll have the same discussion maybe 20 years ago if we're still alive. So that's the way it will be. So
Yeah. That's wonderful. So I think we enjoyed the today's session because you have rightly mentioned that I was just amazing, at my imagination level that what we are going to eat at our old age and how the food will be taken care of and what will be the new food system for my next generation. So I think everybody will agree with me that it was a wonderful session and we were really, really enjoyed the session. So I'm really thankful, Dr. Srivastava, for giving us a time and introducing the concept of techno-economical evaluation for the new tools of the food system and giving us the dairy without cows, eggs without chicken, meat without killing the animals and harnessing microbes as a cell factory. So I think this is not only one thing. So we have to connect the dots, and that Dr. Ramakrishna very beautifully mentioned the connecting the dots for sustainable supply chain with technological upgradation and waste utilization. And Brajesh has very rightly mentioned the adoption of circular economy and biorefinery is the key. With this word, I, on my behalf and on behalf of ICR, IARI, I would like to thank all the speakers for their wonderful insights on the subject, and along with Dr. Alka for helping us to organize this event in a very smooth way. And I'm very thankful to all the participants for their patience listening to us. And I'm very hopeful that the startups must have got a lot of new ideas how they can venture into the food, because the major responsibility with us, how we can feed India in 2050. Without these interventions, without technological advancement, because the resources are same, and in fact, the resources are going to shrink day by day. So how we can take care of ourselves as far as the food and nutritional security is concerned, it is a big concern. So it's a, when there is a challenge, it's an opportunity for business. So that's how the food processing is also presenting a really, really a big opportunity for all of us to take this challenge and to convert this challenge into an opportunity and into a viable business ventures. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nehru, for a wonderful session. Thanks to all the speakers. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks.